which hydroponic system is the best hydroponic system to use? This series aims to answer this. Now, this is episode 2 of the series. I actually only decided to make this a series when I started building out my other systems, and I thought, well, it'd be good to do a bit of an experiment, compare the various methods, and it's a lot of fun, and I'm sure you guys will enjoy it. Now, the first episode was when I set up my Ebb and Flood system. I managed to get some very cheap parts on eBay, so I reconfigured my system inside my large greenhouse over there, and I'll link that video down below. This system that's running inside the polytunnel is also Ebb and Flood, and it's busy doing a cycle right now, so you may hear that in the background. Today we're going to be looking at DWC, or deep water culture. I'll show you how I've set that up inside my little greenhouse, which is on the other side of this greenhouse. But before we look at that, I wanted to just do a bit of an update on something else I spoke about, because it is about hydroponics and I don't think it warrants an entire video on this. I reviewed or unboxed the Cactoily 4-in-1 pH and EC meter, which is an automated meter that I can monitor on Wi-Fi and that sort of thing. And I'd mentioned in that I couldn't really use it until I managed to find some way to have that floating inside my reservoir. And I was going to use a pool noodle or something to create a float. Now, you can still do that, I think. It's up to you. But Cactoily actually heard me in that episode, and they said, well, we do actually sell floats for that. It's another part you have to buy, an accessory. It's on their website. It's not very expensive, but they did send me a couple to have a look at, and I can actually finally put it inside my big reservoir over there. And I think, if I remember correctly, in the last Ebb and Flood video, I was talking about putting in a new tank. Well, I put it in, so we'll have a quick look at that as well. And one other thing we're going to look at is a little bit of a Venturi aeration system. So quite a bit to get through today, not just the DWC, but it's all hydroponics, so I'm sure you guys will enjoy it. So here we have the tank. So much nicer than that portable system that I had before. It's sitting over there, actually. If anybody lives in the Lincolnshire area and wants a 700 or 750 litre portable tank, it's still fine to use. Get in contact with me, you guys can have it. So yeah, I bought this tank. It's really, really nice and solid. It's a bit bigger. Because it's higher, obviously the pump that I'm using has to pump a bit higher up, and it's not really a problem. The pump that was in there was a 3,000 litre pump, and I used to fill the system up pretty well. I have quite a few plants in here, about 24, so to fill up all these buckets could take a little bit of time. It was taking about 15-20 minutes to get them all full. Now, if you know anything about Ebb and Flood, you don't want to have the fill cycle being too long. You don't want the water in the roots for too long. But I mean, it hasn't been a problem. I have been growing successfully with this for a couple of years now. What I did do though is I put a bigger pump in here. It's actually a bit of a cheaper pump than the one that was in. But this thing pumps 7,000 liters, not 3,000. And the system fills up in about 7 minutes or so. It's not about the amount of water, because there's not 7,000 liters of water that's going into these tanks, but it's about how quickly it can fill up through all these pipes. So the more water that's in there, the quicker that it fills, the quicker the whole system works. So lovely tank, love it. Let's get the Cactoily inside here. It's actually doing the ebb side of this, or the drain cycle. Let's go and get the Cactoily and have a look at these floats. So it's quite a nice design. Another problem I think I might have is how long this cable is, because the tank is quite tall, so I don't know. I think it should be all right, actually. It's quite a long cable. But here's the float. It's pretty straightforward. It's just a foam little thingy that slots in here. And because this is kind of tapered, it can fit on quite firmly there. It's not going anywhere. And obviously you want it near the top, because you want that thing dangling down. So, excellent. Yeah, okay. I'm going to untangle this. Good thing is, I have my electronics here. I hate having electronics around water. I'm surprised nobody commented on that in the last video. But this here has some USB outlets, which was exactly for this purpose. So the system, oh, please be long enough. I think we'll be okay. Yep. Perfect. Okay, better unplug the system so we don't start getting water spraying everywhere. I'll take everything apart. So I drilled this little hole over here, which allows the pump cable to come through. And this here is for the pump to pump water through. This one here is for the drain cycle. So it pumps through my little filter here. Let's take that out. Okay. Okay, I think there's another cap I need to put on here. Here we go, so put that cap on there. That goes in, and there you go. Okay, so that's going to plug in. Power. Go. Let's take a look inside there. Should have enough light to be able to see in there. There you go. Yep, it's all the way down there. So, that looks good for now. So, we're going to mount this here. It's nice and magnetic. Nice and neat. And let's just hope it works. Okay. Huh. So, good thing I have this one. That pH is really acidic. So, showing me pH. Couldn't really read this the last time, but hopefully you can see it there. I can read it just fine, actually, even in the sunshine. It says here 1.72 EC, but pH is at 5.4. Now, I'm going to test that because this might need some calibration. So, I'm going to test that with my own pH meter. Well, I've just checked. This is just normal water from my water butts, so there's rainwater, and that is very acidic. 5.7, that's just the rainwater, and when you obviously add nutrients, it's going to drop the pH even further. So I did test the water in here as well with my meter, and it's showing the same pH as the cactolias. So interesting. I need to have a look at why that's happening. Very interesting. Good thing I put this in. But first things first, I need to get the pH back up above 6.2, 6.4, else I'm going to have some problems with my plants. Well, nothing like finding out you have issues during live filming. Well, that's just how it goes. And as you can see, I don't hide anything from you guys. I got some work to do to figure out what's going on here. pH is way too low, so it's very acidic. This product we're going to talk about next actually has an effect on pH itself. It is essentially causing aeration inside your water. So a lack of aeration normally would raise your pH to make it more alkaline. What we're seeing here is a lowering of pH, so it's making it more acidic. This here is going to be pushing air into the system and aerating it. Now, typically with an ebb and flood system, you don't need to aerate because of the way it works. That's one of the reasons I like it. You don't have to have more extra things going on in there and more things to worry about. However, obviously we have some sort of an issue here, so we'll deal with that after this video. This here is a Venturi siphon. So a Venturi siphon, what it does is it creates an area of low pressure that then will pull either air or water into this. So sometimes you'll use a Venturi siphon to mix two liquids. Sometimes, I mean, I've got a video on this that I did ages ago. You can draw nutrients into a water stream, so it'll pull it all together using the Venturi. This one here is just pulling air through this pipe that'll be sticking outside of the tank. So the way it works is it's pumping water through here, the water's coming out there, this is pulling air, and it's gonna push water around, but also it's gonna push bubbles around. So there's two reasons I wanted to put this in, and it'll only be running for like 5 minutes every hour or so. And that is to keep the things circulating within the tank, because it is a large tank, and also to introduce some air in there, because it can never hurt, really. Well, we'll see. We'll see what does to the pH. So that's what this is for. It doesn't need to be on constantly. If you had this in a DWC system that constantly exchanges water across the system, then you probably could use one of these constantly. But this here, it's going to be sitting in the bottom of the tank and just pushing out bubbles and circulating the water. Doesn't matter the orientation, really. This is just the pump that I had inside the reservoir before, the 3,000 liter per hour. We're gonna have a look and see how vigorous the bubbles actually come out, because they say you can use a 1,000 liter pump up to, well, I don't think there's really a limit, but up to like 3,000 or 4,000 liter. So this is a 3,000 liter, it's on the upper end, and hopefully we'll see a good result. So let's just pop that in there. This is the air pipe. I will stick a filter on it. Let's go plug this in. Okay, it should be on now. And we should see some bubbles. Well, you can kind of see the bubbles on that side of the tank. Yeah, you can see it. That's less than I thought there'd be, but it is moving the water around. I can see it circulating there. I have put the nutrients in here. This tank is basically full of my rainwater and nutrients that I'll be using to top that up. And yeah, so right now it's just circulating. It's a good way to mix it up, I guess. Yeah, it's bubbles. It's definitely moving the water around, but I mean, it's a 3,000 liter pump, so it should be moving the water around. And yeah, it's a decent amount of bubbles. So yeah, I'm going to be sticking one of these inside that tank. I'm also going to be sticking one with a smaller pump inside my other reservoir inside the large greenhouse. Oh, there we go. Quick look at this system. So, yeah, I should see quite a decent amount of bubbles there. I guess when it's sitting at the bottom of the tank, it doesn't look as impressive. Yeah, happy with that. Okay, so let's get to it. This is DWC or deep water culture. Now, essentially with hydroponics, there's a couple things that are happening there. Number one, you need water, hydroponics. You need nutrients to feed the plants. And then you also need oxygen. So plants, their roots need oxygen to breathe. So actually I put a video out, I think it was the last video, have a look at that, talking about the need of roots to breathe. So don't overwater, because it can cause some serious problems. It can cause nutrient deficiencies, it can cause rotting of the roots, and that sort of thing. And that is because of the lack of oxygen. So that's with soil plants. No different for hydroponics plants, except probably a little bit more important because these are constantly in water. So what we need to do is get oxygen into the nutrients, because the oxygen in the water gets used up by those roots. So I could turn off the air pumps that I have in here, and there'll be enough oxygen in the water for a while. The plants would be happy for a bit, but they'll start using all that oxygen, and then you'll start seeing some problems. With DWC, why this is different from Ebb Flood, and how does Ebb Flood work in terms of getting oxygen to the roots? Ebb Flood works by flooding a system in hydrotons, so these little clay bowls, which I'm using here in the DWC system as well. These little clay balls, expanded clay, they're basically air and clay. And they can absorb some water and nutrients, but they're very good at aerating where the roots are. With a ebb and flood system, it's flooding into the hydroton, those clay balls. And then after a while, it cycles by draining the system. And when it drains, it's pulling air into the system. So you're getting air to those roots. The roots have access to water and nutrients. And you have a cycle going for like every 4 hours or every 3 hours, depending on how you want to set that up. And every 4 hours, it's going to flood again, give it more nutrients, give it more water. Those roots are going to be happy. It's going to get oxygen. It's going to get nutrients. It's going to get their water. With DWC, it's a little bit different because it's constantly going to have the roots sitting inside liquid. The way that we get around that is by blowing bubbles. So let's have a look. These plants are all started in soil. So what I did is I took the plants. They were in little pots, I think 250 milliliter pots. I rinsed the soil off the roots, gave them a bit of a dunking, gave them a bit of a clean, and then put them inside these clay pebbles. And once they're in the clay pebbles, put them into the system. The system is filled up with water. It's a sealed system. However, it has got these air hoses connected to a little air stone inside here. So these three here were done about 10, 15 days ago. The rest were done about 3 days ago. So let's have a look at the difference here. 10 days ago, now bear in mind, the roots were not poking out yet. But have a look at that. Beautiful, healthy white roots getting lots and lots of oxygen. So they're happy. I have to try and get that in there without damaging anything. Okay, so let's do one without the roots so that you can get a better idea of what's going on inside. Well, even that, 3 days ago, look at the roots coming out. That's incredible. Take the lid off. So these here are oxy pots. They're from IWS, actually the same manufacturers that I bought my bigger system from that I was just showing you inside the polytunnel. But here are the balls that we have blowing air into the system. That there is the same nutrients that I use everywhere, which means I probably, and it's the same water, so I probably have a pH problem in here as well. I need to test that. But yeah, we have the ball in there that's going to constantly push air into the system, and that's how the roots are going to remain oxygenated. Pretty simple, really, and so far pretty happy with the system. Now I'm going to be making some changes. I'll have that ready for the next update on the DWC system, where this is going to be automatically topped up. I'm going to use some float valves connected into each one of these, and I'll have a bucket of water that'll keep these topped up. because unlike Crack Key, which uses a similar system, I guess, where your roots are submerged, Crack Key, your roots, you have air roots at the top and then your other roots are sitting in the water. So there is breathing going on, but a little bit of a different mechanism. This here, it needs to be maintained at a certain level, which is why you have these little things here, so you can top these up. But yeah, if I use a float valve, at least it reduces the amount of maintenance, because that's one of the problems already that I can see with the DWC. There is ongoing maintenance. With my other system, the Ebb and Flood system, because I can have quite a large reservoir in there, I can actually leave that to go as long as I can trust the pumps. I can leave that to go for a good few weeks. So if I'm going away on a holiday, it kind of takes care of itself. With these here, if you don't have something automatically topping them up, you're going to have a problem, especially when the weather gets nice like it is today.
It's going to be super interesting to see how this DWC system performs. Of course, like I mentioned in the beginning of the video, my preference has been Ebb and Flood for a very long time. I've built many systems using it, many different types of Ebb and Flood, same basic concept, but big systems, small systems. I've even got some 3D printed systems that you guys can get access to if you join my Patreon. Go check out Patreon. And yeah, it's going to be interesting to see the performance of it. The DWC system is pretty simple, pretty straightforward to set up and use, so I can see the appeal of it. There's a few things extra that could go wrong. I guess it's no different than the Ebb and Flood system. If the air pump stops working, then obviously it's going to cause issues, but it's the same thing with Ebb and Flood. If the flood and drain system stops working, the one of the two pumps, because there's two pumps there, then there could be an issue. But I have had problems in the past with my Ebb and Flood system where electricity actually switched off, and I never had any cycles going for, I think it was like 3 days, and there was a couple days that were like this, so nice and warm and sunny, but the plants were fine. They weren't entirely happy, but once I got the system running again, they recovered very quickly. I wonder if that would be the case of the DWC system. I may sacrifice one of my plants to test that, where I'll switch off the air pump or take out the air stone, and we'll see how long they can survive like that. Yeah, don't really want to do that, but maybe for science. So the next video is going to be about my NFT system. Now, you might be able to catch a glimpse of it there. I have built it. I'm doing some testing still. There's some things I need to set up on it, but I'll talk about that in the next video. I'll also talk about why potentially I might not be growing chilies in that system. I am growing chilies in the DWC system. I'm also growing chilies in my Ebb and Flood systems, both of them. And that's because I grow chilies. That's what I do. But I might not be doing that in the NFT, and I'll explain why in that next video. So keep an eye out for that. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you so much for watching. And yeah, let me know in the comments down below what systems you've tried in the past and what systems I should try in the future, because I know there are a few other hydroponic systems and that might be for future experiments. I'm running out of space at the moment. Anyway, have a fantastic day. I look forward to seeing you on the next video, and stay spicy.